so many people.
All right, welcome here. Come on in and find a seat if you're not already sitting down. Glad you guys could join us to worship today, both those of you who are online as well as those of you who are here in person. My name is Sean, I'm one of the pastors here. If you're new or visiting or you've only been a couple times, we'd love for you to get connected. We'd love to get to know you, and one of the best ways to do that is to fill out our Connect card either in the pew in front of you, drop it in the offering box in the lobby, or go online to our website, brookswoodbaptist.com/imnew. That's I-M-new. Fill out the digital Connect card, and one of the pastors will be in touch with you later this week. If you have children, we'll be releasing them partway through the service to their Kid Street classrooms down the long hallway, and someone will be there to help you get them checked in. Now, our call to worship this morning comes from Isaiah chapter 55, verses 1 through 3. Isaiah wrote this: "Is anyone thirsty? Come and drink, even if you have no money. Come, take your choice of wine or milk. It's all free. Why spend your money on food or bread that does not give you strength? Why pay for food that does you no good? Listen to me and eat what is good, and you will enjoy the finest food. Come to me with your ears wide open. Listen, and you will find life. For I will make an everlasting covenant with you, and I will give you all the unfailing love that I promised to David." Let me pray for us as we get started. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to gather again as your people in this place to worship you. God, we thank you that you are a God of love and grace and power and life transformation that is worthy of our worship. Father, I recognize that all of us come in here today with lots of stuff going on in our lives, that we are real people with relational problems and financial problems and physical health problems. And God, you know every single one of us, right down to the number of hairs on our head. And so God, I ask that you would today, as we talk about how Jesus is the bread of life, I ask that you would meet us as the bread that we need. And God, I pray that you would be glorified by everything we say and do. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship together.
Yes, let's lift our voices together as a unified body of believers. I invite you to stand if you're able, and we'll sing together.
Thank you.
so good to see all of you. This is our worship team this morning. My name's Connor. This is Nicole and Laura. We have Justin and Peter and Pam. And it's a privilege to be able to lead worship with you guys. Our next song is Yet Not I. And we're going to just get settled and start.
Scripture reading this morning comes from John chapter 6, verses 25 to 40. It's just after Jesus feeds the 5,000, and he and his disciples are traveling across the lake towards Capernaum, starting at verse 25. When they found him on the other side of the lake, the crowd, they asked him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, You are looking for me, not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him, God the Father has placed his seal of approval. Then they asked him, "What must we do to do the works God requires?" Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." So they asked him, "What sign then will you give that we may see it and believe you? What will you do? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life in the world." "Sir," they said, "always give us this bread." Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me, and still you do not believe. All those the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all those he has given me, but raise them up at the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day."
Thank you, Laura. We're going to start a new song called Abide. Our young adults for BC Baptist Conference have been meeting, and we're planning to come together and start to unify our young adults across our conference. And the theme of Abide has been near and dear to our hearts as young adults in this conference, and the song specifically talking about asking God to teach us to abide, and the message in John about being the God being, we are the branch and he is the vine, and that we want to draw near and be taught how to abide in Christ, because it is so important in our daily walk with God. And so, yeah, sing this song with us.
For my waking breath, for my daily bread, I depend on you, oh, I depend on you. For the sun to rise, for my sleep at night, I depend on you, oh, I depend on you. You're the way, the truth, and the life. You're the well that never runs dry. I'm the branch and you are the vine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. Where the Spirit leads, as I'm following, I depend on you, oh, I depend on you. For the victory's still in front of me, I depend on you, oh, I depend on you. You're the way, the truth, and the life. You're the strength, my song in the night. Be my all, my treasure, my prize. I am yours forever, you're mine. Draw me close and teach me to abide.
When I pass through death, as I enter,
teach me to abide. Be my strength, my song in the night. Be my all, my treasure, my prize. I am yours forever, you're mine. Draw me close and teach me to depend on you. I depend on you. I depend on you. I depend on you. Oh, I depend on you. I depend on you.
You may be seated.
Well, we have a couple of announcements for you today. We just wrapped up, if you don't know, 3 weeks of summer camps a week ago. And we had, by God's grace, over 100 awesome, amazing, energetic kids here and 20-plus volunteers, plus many more who, you know, baked cookies and snacks and things like that, helped us clean up afterwards, who all participated. And so if you didn't participate, it was a lot of fun, and you should participate next year because you'll be blessed by it. But we have a little video we want to actually show, just a real short kind of minute and a half video of some of the highlights of our 3 weeks of camp. And as they cue that up, I just want to let you know that we actually had over 20 kids who placed their faith in Christ this year. So we have a lot of, yeah, go ahead and clap. A lot of return kids who placed their faith in Christ last year and the year before that came back. And then we had new kids that did it again this year. And we always teach kind of the salvation message using the ABCs. So A, admit you're a sinner. B, believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins. And C, you know, choose to follow Jesus as your Savior and Lord for the rest of your life. And so we tell the kids that, and a number of the kids made that decision to place their faith in Christ. So praise God. Go ahead and roll the video. So yeah, once again, I just want to say a huge thank you to everyone who participated and volunteered and baked things and helped us get set up and cleaned up. Couldn't do it without you, and it was a wonderful, exciting experience again. At this time, now that the video's over, we're going to release the kids, age 3 to grade 6, to go down to their Kid Street classrooms and get checked in there. And while they go, I want to invite you guys to come back tonight. If you haven't heard, we are having sort of a missions event tonight. It's a dessert extravaganza themed around watching a documentary about sort of the persecuted and underground church in countries that we can't name. And so we have a partnership with the House of Omid in Coquitlam, and Ahmad, who's there, who I know, part of a small group of pastors I meet with on a monthly basis, is doing a wonderful ministry both here in Canada but also in countries overseas where the church is largely underground. And so he's got a documentary which is fantastic, and it will strengthen your faith if you come tonight and watch this documentary that tells the story of our brothers and sisters in Christ who live in a radically different kind of situation than we do here, where we can gather like this on a Sunday morning. That's not their reality. So tonight at 6:30, I invite you to come out and have your faith strengthened and hear about how we as a church and you can help support a ministry like this and our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world who really need our prayer and our support. So 6:30 tonight, come back and be a part of that. I also want to let you know that coming up this Wednesday, we're having a second kind of Q&A town hall meet and greet where you can come out and you can ask me questions. I've been put forth as the candidate for lead pastor, and there's a vote next Sunday. And if you're not sure, come out this Wednesday and ask questions at 7 to 8 o'clock in the Student Center. We just did one of these last night. There's about 20, 25 people there, and I fielded questions from the congregation, and it was a good time. So that's happening again this Wednesday, the 17th, if you want to come out. So that said, next Sunday, right after the service, we're going to have a vote on whether or not to call me as the next lead pastor of this church, and you get to make the choice. So I leave it to you, and we trust God with the outcome. But that will happen right after the service at 11:30. If you are not able to be here, you can, if you're a member, vote by proxy, which means you take a little form that's on the info desk, and you write, you know, I, member so-and-so, authorize this other member to vote for me on August 21st. And so that person then can vote in person in your place. It'll be a written, you know, checkmark ballot. So we invite as many members as possible to participate in that. This is obviously a huge decision in the life of the church, and we want God's will. So if you're a member, take advantage of your membership and come and vote next Sunday. I know this is a little ways away, but not too far. Fall kickoff. Many of you guys are thinking haven't gone on vacation yet, but fall kickoff is happening September 11th. And we're having a fun fair again, similar to last year. So we're going to have a dunk tank and mini donuts and a bouncy castle for kids and other events set up. It's a lot of fun. We had a good time last year getting Pastor Pamelina all wet in the dunk tank. myself too. So plan on sticking around on September 11th after church. So from 11:30 to 1:30, it's kind of just hang out. We're going to have a free barbecue and all these fun events. It's a good way to kind of end the summer and start the fall back in church together, getting to know one another. So just sort of plan ahead for that. That video that you watched about summer camps was put together by one of our summer interns, James VanderMeulen, who's sitting off to my right over here. He's also a man of many gifts. And today, we have the privilege of actually hearing James bring the sermon from the Word of God. And the reason I asked James to do this is he's been an intern with us for two summers. As well, he was kind of on staff part-time last year, helping us with media and technology. But it was clear from the first time he interned with us that he had gifting in the area of sort of Bible knowledge and Bible understanding and teaching, and he was passionate about this. And so this summer when he was interning with us again and we kind of did a little strengths assessment, communication came out of one as one of his sort of top strengths as well. And I thought, hey, I wonder if he's ever had a desire to preach a sermon. You know, he's only, how old are you now? 19. He just turned 19 this summer. But I thought, hey, that's fantastic, because one thing that I care about is leadership development. And I want the next generation to know that God wants to use them, not 20 years from now, but now. And so, hey, we want to get James up here. We think God's gifted him in this area, and no one's going to get to where God wants him to be if we don't give him experiences on the way there. People gave me experiences like that, and I want to, you know, kind of pay that forward and pass it on. So I'm excited to introduce James here in a minute. He's going to come up and preach a sermon for us. So pray for him and encourage him and clap for him, and he's going to do a great job. Let me pray for the offering, and then we'll invite him up. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a great God, and you are worthy of all of our worship. Father, I thank you that you have placed us in this body, that we are a family, and that we need each other. And I thank you that you have gifted us all in radically different ways, so that people can do things that I can't do, And God, I'm so blessed by having those people in this congregation. So God, I pray that every person here would find their place in this body where you want to use them, where they will be blessed and they will be a blessing to others. Father, I pray for James as he comes up here. God, fill him with your Holy Spirit. Open our hearts to what you want to say through him in your word. And God, I pray that life transformation would happen through your word and by your spirit in these next moments, because we know that's what you want. And Father, I pray that you would move each one of us to continue to surrender our lives more fully to you every day, and that includes in the area of giving. And God, I pray that you would take our tithes and offerings and you would use them to help people who do not yet know you come to know you, both here in Brookswood and around the world through our missionaries. And Father, I pray for our brothers and sisters who are in countries where the name of Jesus is not publicly welcome. God, I pray you would strengthen them today as they gather. And God, I pray that life transformation will happen there. And God, I pray that as we gather tonight, that we would be encouraged and we would find a way to partner with and support and love our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world. God, we thank you that you are good and that we get to be here not based on our performance, but based on the fact that you loved us unconditionally while we were yet sinners and sent your son to die for us. Thanks for the kids that understood the gospel this summer and made the decision to step across the line of faith into relationship with you. God, we trust you to continue to do all these things and more, because you are a great God who loves to do great things. In Jesus' name, amen. Help me welcome James to the stage.
Is this on?
Hello, hello? Ah, there we go. I know we just prayed, but I'd like to open with a word of prayer just very quickly. Dear Father, I thank you that you have gathered us here to worship you today. I thank you that you have given me this opportunity to speak your words of truth, and I thank you that it is not my wisdom or my ideas that matter, but yours. I pray that truth would be heard this morning, and that every word of yours would echo with power, and every word of my own would be forgotten. I thank you for your presence here. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. When I was younger, I would often go over to my friend's house, usually with my family, since my parents were close with her parents and my siblings didn't have anywhere else to go. Whenever we'd go over, one of our favorite things to do was to play this video game called Outdoor Challenge. It was a game for the Nintendo Wii where you would plug in this pressure-sensitive mat and complete a series of challenges, things like log jumping and racing, mole stomping, etc. I'm sure my parents were very thrilled to have us so enamored with exercise at the time. We would go over there and we would play this game for hours on end as much as we possibly could. It was our favorite thing to do at their house. And one day, my friend's mom was talking to my 4-year-old brother and she said, "Peter, I love you," with all of the affection that a mother and a family friend can offer. And my brother, the 4-year-old social master that he was, responded with great honesty and heartfelt childish enthusiasm and said, "Christy, I love your Wii." It's a very wholesome moment of a child's brutal honesty. And I know that we really did love my friend and her family, but in that particular instant, the amusement of a video game felt much more immediate and tangible to our small child minds than the somewhat vague idea of loving a person for themselves. And the truth is, I don't think we ever fully grow out of that phase of our lives. Especially now in today's culture where everything is about how much you can get for how little and how quickly. Buy it now while supplies last. It can be very easy for us to forget our love for God, reduce it to Sundays only, and focus on the small things we can get now. Today's passage is from John chapter 6, verses 25 to 40, which we read just a moment ago. And this chapter takes place shortly after the feeding of the 5,000, where Jesus takes a young boy's lunchbox of fish and bread, and he transforms it into a grand feast, enough to stuff everyone in the crowd with 12 whole baskets to spare. And, of course, with such a glamorous miracle, the crowd is enamored with Jesus, and they follow him across the sea to the other side, and this is where our scene begins. This huge crowd of followers has followed Jesus across a storm-prone sea without food or supplies. They were dedicated to finding him, but when they finally arrive, they don't get the sort of approval that you might expect. There's no thank you for your devotion, for yours is the kingdom of God. Instead, Jesus has a rebuke for them. They were following him for all the wrong reasons. They weren't looking for him. They just wanted the bread that he could offer. Now, I don't think any of you came to church this morning because you wanted bread. I don't think you expected any of the pastors to step up on stage and say, "Thank you all for following Jesus. Would you like whole wheat or gluten-free?" If you wanted that, you should have come for communion last week. But even if we're not looking just for bread, I think we all come to church with certain expectations of what we're going to get out of it. What am I going to get out of church this morning? What's in it for me? Today, I want to look at the two biggest mistakes the crowd makes in this passage and the answer that Jesus gives in an effort to correct their course. The first mistake is a sin of idolatry. The crowd was following Jesus because they wanted bread, not because they wanted him. They wanted what Jesus could get them, and they saw him just as a means to an end. Verse 25, when they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" And Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him God the Father has placed his seal of approval." The Bible tells us that God is a giver of good gifts. James 1:17 says, "Every good and perfect gift comes from above, coming down from the Father." Matthew 7:11 says, "If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him?" It cannot and it should not be disputed that God does love to bless his children. However, these gifts are not the end objective. Jesus did give the crowd bread. He fed the crowd and provided for their physical need, but they weren't able to see the greater spiritual need that they had, the need that Jesus was trying to get them to see through his miracle. Jesus' miracles are called signs for a reason. Signs are meant to guide and to point onward. Later today, I'm going on a road trip to Alberta, and when we cross through the mountains and see the big sign that says, "Welcome to Alberta," we aren't going to stop the car, get out, and say, "We're here, road trip over." There's nothing. There's rocks, a road, a sign. But the sign isn't there to be a destination. It's there to tell you that what you're really looking for is further ahead of you. You're on the right track, and if you keep going, then you'll get what you're really looking for. Jesus' gift of bread to the crowd was not the purpose of his teaching. He didn't come to minister on earth to get people lunch. The temporary bread that he gave them was meant to be a sign to point them forward towards the eternal bread that he offers. But the crowd got stuck on the bread that filled their stomach, and they didn't search for anything better. They stopped at the road sign. The crowd's mistake is the same mistake that is made by the prosperity gospel today. Famous televangelist Joel Osteen has made millions of dollars off of this message. His best-selling book, selling over 8 million copies, is titled "Your Best Life Now." His message is that if you obey God and give to his ministry, God will be pleased with you, and he will make you happy, healthy, and wealthy now. Never mind that Jesus himself was not wealthy or successful by worldly standards at all. The prosperity gospel says that God wants you to be rich and powerful and affluent. All you have to do is give enough to Olsteen's ministry, $7.99 for the blessings of God. And do you see the issue? One of them at least. The prosperity gospel puts worldly success over top of God. It turns God into a simple means to the end of worldly success. It's idolatry. It puts you on a road trip to success where God is just the sign that you quickly glance at and then move on to make sure you're on the right track. And needless to say, this is not the gospel. It is constantly stated and restated throughout Scripture that the Bible is not meant to be a means to worldly success. Those who follow Christ for the sake of glory and material riches are constantly denounced by Scripture. It doesn't mean that money and success are bad, but desiring them more than God is. And it's not just money. We can idolize immaterial blessings too. Things like the close community of a church, a sense of belonging with our friends, support in hard times. It's important to remember that even these good things, which we can easily see as more spiritual or pure than material gratification, even these things are meant to be signposts to God. The community that you experience at church is meant to point towards the perfect unity of God. The support that we offer those in times of need is meant to be a reflection of God's provision. All of it points back to God. He is the objective and not any of those good things that you experience in the meantime. The crowd was following Jesus not because they wanted a relationship with him or because they wanted to hear what he had to say. They just wanted the bread. They just wanted the material blessings. And Jesus calls them out on that. He warns them, "Do not work for food that spoils." The problem with temporary blessings isn't that they're bad or evil, but it's that they don't last. No matter how nice they are, they spoil over time and fade away. And if we're putting our time and energy and even our faith into working towards things that are impermanent, then eventually when that food spoils, we're going to be left with nothing. This is the crowd's first mistake, idolatry, running after things other than God. So instead of working for food that spoils, Jesus tells them to work for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. And of course, the crowd is interested. They came all this way for food, so eternal food is sounding pretty good right now. Verse 28, then they said to him, "What must we do to be doing the works of God, the work that will get us this eternal bread?" And Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent." And Jesus' command is surprisingly simple. You would think that for such a rich treasure as eternal bread, eternal sustenance, surely you have to complete some grand quest to earn it, right? Some great feat of humanity. But no, all you have to do to obtain this incredible treasure is to believe in the one God has sent, Jesus. And so with the secret revealed, the crowd should turn and say, "We believe, give us this bread," but this is where they make their second mistake, a sin of pridefulness. Verse 30, so they said to him, "Then what sign do you do that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform? Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Jesus was making a steep claim about himself, as he tends to do. And this isn't lost on the crowd. They know what he's saying, and they respond with hesitation and cynicism. So they ask Jesus for a sign, something to prove that he is who he says he is. "Jesus, what are your credentials?" And like before, it's important to remember that there is a balance. It's not wrong to desire evidence for faith. If you told me that the sky outside had suddenly turned purple, I would want to see it for myself. God built in us a healthy desire to seek the truth and to seek evidence. Psalm 34, verse 8 says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good. God does not require blind faith. We are invited to experience his goodness firsthand. However, what the crowd is asking for here is different. John 6:2, at the opening of this whole chapter, it reads, "A great crowd of people followed him because they saw the signs he had performed." This is the same crowd. They gathered in the first place because they saw the signs. And moreover, the day they arrived, Jesus split a young boy's lunchbox into enough food to feed 5,000 people with more leftovers than they started with. What do you call that but a sign? And yet, here they are again, not 24 hours later, and they're asking Jesus, "How can we believe you if you don't show us a sign?" And finally, as if the finishing touch on the absurdity of this scene, the very sign that they suggest that will cause them to believe is if Jesus gives them bread. Verse 31, "Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Moses gave our ancestors manna, so what can you do? Honestly, I wouldn't blame Jesus for blowing up at them at this point. "Ye of little faith, what do you think I did for you yesterday? If giving you bread is all that you need to believe, then why don't you get it?" This is the mistake that the crowd makes. Their mistake is not asking Jesus for a reason to believe, but it's that in their pride, they appointed themselves judge over Jesus' testimony. They declared the signs he had performed invalid, and they demanded that he satisfy their new requirements. I watched a sermon done by Pastor Colin Smith as I was researching for this sermon, and he had a very good insight on the crowd's request. Next slide. In their minds, Moses had done a better miracle. You see, Jesus fed 5,000, but Moses fed 2 million. Jesus provided one meal, but in the time of Moses, the manna was provided continually for 40 years. The crowd had seen Jesus' signs. They had been given evidence, and a lot of evidence at that. But they looked at the evidence and turned their nose up. It's not good enough for them, so Jesus had better cough up something more impressive and quick, or he's going to lose them. Their mistake is an issue of pride. The gospel is not a presentation on an episode of Shark Tank. It's not a sales pitch where we are a panel of judges that Jesus must impress so that we'll sponsor his gospel. He doesn't need us to fund his projects. God has provided his signs. He has offered his evidence. He has made his terms and conditions clear in 66 books in the novel we call the Bible. What audacity possesses us to think that we are in a position to issue an ultimatum to the creator of the universe? "You must prove yourself to me." That is the second mistake that the crowd makes. Pride to take a place of judgment over God. And that is a grave one. The temptation of proof is quite possibly one of the most deadly in our modern day culture. "I only believe in what I can see. I just don't think there's enough evidence. I need the proof." If you were to ask just about any non-believer off the street why they aren't a Christian, their answer would probably sound something like this. But God already provided the evidence. He has over 2,000 years of his work recorded in the pages of the Bible, and another 2,000 years of preservation just so we can see those signs for ourselves in its pages. And besides that, he's still at work today, performing signs in people's lives continually. My old Bible teacher witnessed a woman's leg be healed miraculously right before his eyes. My brother has felt God's hand on his shoulder. I have family friends who have seen angels. I myself have felt his presence in moments that leave absolutely no room for doubt. And yet still, I find myself sitting in my car, wondering if God is actually real. Sometimes I have to harshly hold myself back from making the same mistake as the crowd and demanding that God prove himself to me. Show me a sign. I want to indulge my pride and appoint myself judge and jury. And I don't think I'm alone. I think we've all had moments like this. After all, it's so easy to give in to that temptation. In the moment, it feels simple. God doesn't require blind faith, right? I just need a sign, something I can hold on to and say, see, God is good. He gave me this. Except he's already given you a sign. He gave you a sign back then. You saw it. You praised him for it. He gave you the loaves and fish. He answered your prayer. But now, a day later, here you are back and you need more. But that was then. This is now, you say. I need reassurance now. Last time, maybe it was a coincidence. Maybe I misinterpreted it. But this time, I just need the one sign, and then I can hold on to that, and I will know for sure. Until the next time. And the next time. And the time after that. We are fickle and forgetful creatures. We have been given our evidence. If your faith is conditional once, it will be conditional forever. These are the two errors that the crowd makes. First, a sin of idolatry, placing God in the role of a signpost that we just have to get past on the way to the real treasure. And secondly, the sin of pride, issuing an ultimatum to the creator of the universe, placing ourselves in the judgment seat that is reserved for God and God only. Okay, so what does Jesus think? How does Jesus respond to all of this? At this point, he's done with his hints and nudges. They clearly don't understand what he's saying. And so he prepares for his monologue, the big teaching. And he sets the bait. He draws the crowd in. Verse 32. Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven." Next slide. "For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. The bread that Moses gave you is not from heaven. It was material bread like any other. Supernatural provision, absolutely. But I am here to give you the true bread from heaven, which gives life to the whole world." And of course, the crowd takes the bait. This is what they've been looking for. And so they sit on the edge of their seat and respond eagerly. "Sir," they said, "always give us this bread." And Jesus drops the bombshell of this passage, verse 35. "Then Jesus declared, 'I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty.'" All right, thank you for coming. Sermon over. God be with you. Honestly, this right here is one of those verses that you can take and say, this is the gospel. And if you get nothing else out of this morning, please remember this verse. John 6, 35, "I am the bread of life." The crowd that has been following Jesus has made the mistake of looking to earthly things to inform their heavenly perspective. Either in idolatry, looking for earthly things as the goal and treating God as just a way to achieve earthly greatness, or in pride, judging their earthly blessings as a measurement of spiritual greatness, determining if Jesus is someone who really deserves their faith. And right here, Jesus, in one sentence, blows both ideas completely out of the water. Pride and idolatry, no, I am the bread of life. First, you no longer need earthly blessings to satisfy you. The bread of life will satisfy you like nothing else. You will never hunger. You will never thirst. You will lack nothing. Jesus is utterly satisfying. Nothing he can give you, nothing he can tell you will satisfy you, only him. Jesus is enough. I want to take a look at the story of Job. Job is a man who is wealthy in every measurable way, but suddenly, though he is described as perfectly righteous before God, God allows him to lose everything. If following God is just a means to get material blessings, then when Job loses everything, there's no reason for him to follow God anymore. And this is what his wife and his friends tell him: curse God, give up, and die. If God was with you, this wouldn't have happened. Clearly, you are not as righteous as you think you are. And eventually, Job does demand an explanation. He wants to know why this has happened. And God honors his request. He shows up, but he doesn't give Job an explanation. At the end, Job isn't left with anything that he can see to say, "See, God is good. He gave me this. He told me this. I have this blessing, and so I know that it's worth it." The only thing that happens to Job is that God shows up. Essentially, his entire response can be boiled down to, "I'm God." And the craziest part, if that wasn't crazy enough, is that this is enough for Job. In the midst of this, he cries out to God and says, "My ears had heard of you." Next slide. "My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore, I despise myself, and I repent in dust and ashes." God revealed himself to Job, and that one truth, that one experience, was enough to cause him to repent and follow. With not a penny to his name, and covered in infected boils, scraped pottery, and mourning the loss of his family, with no hope of anything better in the future, Job picks up his mat and walks after God, satisfied by God's raging revelation that "I am who I am." Job gained nothing. No money, no community, no bread. But he saw that God was the one thing that fulfilled him, and he decided it was enough. Jesus is enough. Secondly, earlier the crowd was asking for a sign from Jesus. They asked for a miracle greater than Moses' bread from heaven. And do you remember Jesus' response? Verse 32, Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven." What he's saying is the true bread from heaven, that is the real miracle. Moses' bread was not the true sign, the true bread from heaven is. And what is the true bread from heaven? Well, Jesus is. And so what this means is that Jesus did not just perform miracles greater than Moses, though he did. He did not just facilitate greater signs. He did not come down to bring people the true bread from heaven. He is the true bread from heaven. He is the sign. Jesus himself, his very existence as a man on earth, is a greater miracle than anything else. His very existence was the sign in and of itself. The very fact that he lived, died, and rose again is the miracle. That is the testimony that we are offered as evidence to believe. That is Jesus' credentials. Jesus is the bread from heaven. Jesus is the miracle. He is the sign. And suddenly, Jesus' refusal to offer them a sign makes a lot more sense. Why would you ask him to show you a sign when he himself, his very life, is testimony and the greatest sign that you could ever receive? This is why he says next, I am the bread of life, verse 36. But as I told you, you have seen me, and still you do not believe. You asked for a greater sign than Moses, but you have seen me, the greatest miracle and sign I could offer, and still you do not believe. So what sign should I show you? What sign greater than God incarnate in the flesh, come to love the world and defeat death? What sign greater than that should I show you so that you will believe? Jesus is sufficient. He is enough. And Jesus is the sign. Once again, Jesus could have stopped here, but he doesn't. He ends this passage with a monologue and a set of promises. Verse 37, all those the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all those he has given me, but raise them up at the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. Jesus has dropped the bomb. He has set the prize before them, the true bread from heaven. As I picture this scene, I can see the crowd muttering to themselves, full of cynics, of hopefuls, and people who are just confused. And I can see a few people in the middle of this crowd who feel a tug towards Jesus, who hear the truth in his words. And this is where Jesus speaks to those people. Those the Father gives me will come to me. This is both a reassurance and a call. To those who felt the voice of God in Jesus' words, he reassures them. This is the hand of God. You are not deluded. You are not mistaken. This is God's direction. And secondly, he calls them. Those the Father gives me, come to me. He speaks through the confusion of the uncertain and the opposed, and he tells the willing exactly what their next step is. Come to him. And he continues to reassure. By following them, they know they will be cast out from their culture, their homes, their places of worship. But Jesus reassures them. If you follow me, you have a place. You will never be driven out. And when I say never, I mean never, because it is the will of the Father that those who believe in me will have eternal life and that I will raise them up at the last day. This is the reassurance that is spoken to the world today. People who hear the gospel and who aren't sure. People who are afraid of what they could lose by following Jesus. After all, if you leave this world behind and this Jesus guy turns out to be a hoax, what are you left with? This might even be something that you're struggling with today. And if you are, Jesus has a reassurance for you that you will never be abandoned. You can live a life filled with purpose and direction, filled with ultimate and eternal satisfaction as you live this new life. And all of this is a package deal with simply coming to Christ. It does not come with a new car. So if that's a deal breaker for you, then Christianity might not be for you. But if you are willing to look past the perishing bread of this world, those temporary rewards that make you feel pretty good for now, for a few minutes until you're hungry again, if you can take Jesus at his words, then these words are for you. He is calling you. He is speaking to you. You are offered something eternal, something perfect, and something utterly satisfying and sufficient in place of the temporary bread of this world. And that something is a man and a God who loved you so much that he died and defeated death so he could love you for all of eternity. Let's pray. Dear Father, once again, I thank you that you have gathered us here today. I thank you that you have given your words to your people, and I pray that everyone here would hear your voice speaking to them, and that they would have something to take with them into the week, that they would know their next step. Once again, I thank you that you call us and that you are eternally sufficient. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to sing Christ Be Magnified together. Please stand if you're able and join us singing.
Were creation suddenly articulate, with a thousand tongues to lift one cry, then from north to south and east to west, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Were the whole earth echoing his eminence, his name would burn sea and sky, from rivers to the mountaintops, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Every creature finds its inmost melody, and every human heart its native cry, then in one enraptured hymn of praise, we'll sing Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Now I won't bow to idols, I'll stand strong and worship you. If it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice cause you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings, I'll hold fast to what is true. If the cross brings transformation, I'll be crucified with you. Cause death is just a doorway into resurrection life. If I join you in your suffering, then I'll join you when you rise. And when we turn in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing, my song will be the same. No, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified in the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Thank you.
Thank you so much for being with us today, both online and in person. James, thanks so much for pointing us to Christ, the bread of life. Invite you back tonight, 6:30. Come watch the documentary about the persecuted church. And hear this benediction written by Nancy Townell. She said this. She said, filled to the brim with the goodness of God and the nourishment of Jesus Christ, the bread of life, and the power of the Holy Spirit, go now in peace to serve God in all that you think, do, and say. And God's peace will always be with you. Amen. Have a great week, everyone. We'll see you next time. If you'd like prayer, there's always prayer people out the front.